As President Obama winds down his time in the White House, we will be looking back at the legacy of his presidency in the coming weeks. Tonight, as part of our partnership with the Atlantic magazine, my conversation with writer Ta-Nehisi Coates about his cover story, My President Was Black.
I think so many African Americans got so much joy out of the image of Barack and Michelle and Malia and Sasha. The first family, and that was going away, and there was a kind of sadness.
Can you put into words how much his election meant in the first place?
The notion of an African-American president for black people was perceived as being so impossible that most of the great, you know, sort of representations of it are in comedy. It's just a moment that seemed so impossible and so far off that actually, you know, it came to be, it actually happened.
You spent a lot of time with him over his 8 years in the White House, and you spent a lot more time thinking about him. And what comes across is really a better understanding of why he was able to get elected in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
His own upbringing, being raised in a white family, in essence.
Well, it was a unique situation. I mean, it's not a lot of attention, rightfully so, gets focused on the fact that the president is biracial, black, biracial man. But it wasn't, you know, African Americans actually have quite a few biracial black people, you know, throughout our history, from Frederick Douglass, Booker T. Washington, Bob Marley, you know, so on. Then, you know, that's not an unfamiliar thing. What's unique about the president is that he was born into the house, you know, of a white woman and her parents in Hawaii, you know, which was far, far from the fulcrum of Jim Crow. At a time when, you know, the marriage between his mother and father was illegal in, you know, broad swaths of the country, the very conception of him himself was taboo. And yet in this family and in this place of Hawaii, there was great, great security and there was great love, and not a kind of love or security that required a denial of himself as a black man. In fact, it was actually confirmed, and it was no contradiction, you know, between, you know, this white family loving him deeply and him being black. That is incredibly, incredibly unique. I've never come across that in my life, actually.
And that made him somebody really
different.
Unusual, different,
yeah.
in the course of the American political history.
When it came time to campaign to a broader audience beyond the African American community, it wasn't like particularly difficult for him to extend, you know, himself in that particular way. He saw his family, you know. I mean, literally, actually, his family, you know, when he went to campaign.
You write about the unique nature of his background and who he was and how he accepted and believed in and trusted the American people. You wrote, made it possible for a majority of Americans to support him.
I really became convinced of the kind of optimism he showed about the country, and frankly, the kind of optimism that, you know, he showed about, you know, white Americans, which is very, very hard for African Americans, you know, to muster in the way that he did, was in fact genuine and was real. He wasn't faking it, you know, and I think people felt that.
He comes into office with his own high expectations of himself and his ability to get a lot done. He immediately runs into opposition.
The reforms I'm proposing would not apply to those who are here illegal.
That doesn't go away.
Mm-hmm.
And that, it inevitably shapes his legacy, the way he connects with the American people.
He showed a kind of optimism about the country that maybe a lot of African Americans could not show, and that actually enabled him to win. But in fact, once he got there, he didn't deploy the skepticism that the optimism actually hurt, but that the skepticism that most African Americans would have held, like they would not have been surprised by many of the things that he was actually surprised by.
Whenever he would bring up an issue or a subject connected to race in the early years of his presidency, he got a significant amount of blowback.
You know, one of the things I really tried to appreciate is he was always walking this line, and he had to walk the line. You know what I mean? Like, if you're president of the United States, it is true that the majority of people who you serve, who you represent, that's not the South Side of Chicago anymore. That's not what you're representing a much, much broader country. And at the same time, I think deep in his heart, you know, like he didn't, you know, necessarily want to lie either. In other words, you know, he didn't want to flatter, you know, egos. He didn't want to, you know, flatten out history. And so I think he was always wrestling with that tension. How am I honest about this country's history? And at the same time, speak to the goodness that I actually see, you know, in the broader country.
How has he embraced being black?
Yeah.
How does he see that as part of who he is?
Yeah, I think he did that relatively early on. And I think, like, this is, again, like, the uniqueness of his background. There was no incentive or pressure in his house to not be black. That didn't really exist. I mean, he, you know, jokingly said to me, you know, while I was interviewing, but I think he, you know, he was being truthful, that his mother thought black people were cool. You know? Now, you can say that's naive, that's whatever, but it's a lot better than thinking they're horrible. You know what I mean? And so he talked about how he had, you know, he said, listen, when I was, you know, coming up, I had, you know, people like Marvin Gaye, Thurgood Marshall, Dr. J. I mean, these are the people who I, you know, looked up to. So I think from a very, very early age, he had a kind of, I mean, people, to be clear, I mean, the black community in Hawaii is considerably smaller, but there is a black community. It is there. And it was there for him. So I think he had it early on, you know, that he was black. I mean, that was just how he saw himself.
He wasn't dealing with the same pressure, daily pressure.
No.
So many African Americans.
Not at all. I had to ultimately see it as a tremendous privilege and a tremendous gift, actually. To be away from the kind of grinding poverty, even if it's not in your house, that is actually around you. To not go to schools and wonder why your schools are, you know, are terrible, to not have to deal with the fear, the violence, and not really have to deal with the police. So he was aware of it, but it wasn't personal. It wasn't within him. It wasn't within his family.
And so did that steel him against the string of opposition, insults, and so forth?
Yeah, I just think he was untraumatized, so it didn't bring any sort of past memories up. And that he, and you know, took his share of racist insults, you know, during the time when he was president, all sorts of horrible things. But it doesn't, emotionally, it doesn't call anything back to him. He's not remembering, this is like what they said when I was 7 years old or whatever. The trauma is not there.
And did that make him stronger when he faced what he faced as president?
I think so, although going back to what we were talking about before, it may not have given him the requisite skepticism. You know, it's like two sides. It's two sides. Yes, it did make him strong. It did mean that when someone stands up and you're giving an address and yells, "You lie," you just sort of, what's wrong with that guy? Like, you don't go back and you don't storm and you don't have, like, memories that it, you know, conjures up. It doesn't quite do that to you. But at the same time, you know, someone else might have expected someone to stand up and yell, "You lie."
And it also, you write, contributed to his not seeing the potential appeal of a Donald Trump.
Yeah. That is where the real tragedy for me comes in the sense that I saw the president in the spring, and he said of Trump, you know, he said he can't win. You know, he said he couldn't perceive Donald Trump as actually, you know, winning. And as he was hearing, you know, this wave of insults, you know, that were coming in, I think, over, you know, throughout the campaign, in his America, that wouldn't play. I mean, what he said to me, just to, you know, give the most scientific, I guess, analysis of this, is that it's very hard to win an election in America by appealing to people's darkest instincts. And it didn't quite go that way.
One of the things you write is that it has to do with the election of Donald Trump being the price that has to be paid for having Barack Obama as president. Mm-hmm. What did you mean by that?
Well, I meant that, you know, if having, you know, an African American president was as revolutionary as we claim it was, that there'll probably be, you know, some sort of, you know, backlash or some sort of counter. That's generally been true. That's the first thing. The second thing is a great deal of Barack Obama's power is symbolic and is in the symbolism and what it communicates to African Americans. And you know, the thing that, you know, has become so poignant for this is the picture in the Oval Office where the president is bending down and a young boy, you know, is touching his hair and, you know, basically said, "Your hair looks like mine." And that communicated great symbolism to African Americans and great power to African Americans. But that also communicates things to other people also who may not, you know, necessarily be so happy about, you know, that kind of progress, you know, who have all sorts of feelings, you know, wrapped up in that. And so I think a lot of that, you know, culminated, you know, in the election of the president-elect. I think that those two things work together. You know, it doesn't mean that all white people, or even, you know, necessarily most white people looked at that picture and said, well, I don't like that. It just meant that we have a significant, not insubstantial minority of people in this country, you know, who being white actually really means something to them. It gives them something.